Good day, dear friends. Today I am speaking on PET CT basics. It is basically molecular imaging. What exactly is molecular imaging? Molecular imaging is defined as visualization, characterization, and measurement of the biological processes, molecular and cellular levels in human and other living systems. Molecular imaging typically consists of two-dimensional or three-dimensional imaging as well as quantification over the times. Now, molecular imaging differs from traditional imaging in that probes known as biomarkers are used to image particular targets or pathways. Biomarkers, they interact chemically with their surroundings and in turn alter the image according to molecular changes occurring within the areas of interest. Thus, PET is an excellent molecular imaging modality which has evolved. What is PET? PET is positron emission tomography and CT is computed tomography. So combination of PET and CT is PET CT. It is a combination of functional imaging as well as anatomical imaging. Thus, 18F FDG PET is a metabolic imaging technique that uses radiolabeled analog of glucose as glucose utilization is increased in malignancies. CT is a tomographic imaging technique that uses an X-ray beam to produce an anatomic images. Everyone of us know about the CT tomographic imaging. So why we need anatomic information along with the PET? The anatomic information is needed to detect, determine the location and extent of malignancies. Thus, PET CT scanner is an integrated device, both CT scanner and a PET scanner. It is a single table, patient table, and obtained first with CT or PET, or we can do both. Most of the times we are doing both. Previously, there was only PET, so PET was alone being done. So PET CT is a fusion where the alignment of PET and CT images are fused, combined image display and analysis can be done. Thus, fused images, they are color-coded by in the PET data and CT data is usually the grayscale. Some history about the PET. SNM 2000 PET was released. PET CT was released. CPS Innovation Knoxville, USA. They introduced first dedicated PET CT, which was released at RSNA in the same year. So Somatown Sensation, it is a 16 slice CT, which has full ring PET detectors. So PET CT, PET and CT are combined, integrated in a single gantry and images are acquired separately. And PET imaging is done with radio tracer, which is commonly used as 2,18F fluorodeoxydeglucose, that is FDG. It forms the basis of this evolution in modern medicine, which aims towards the mantra of contemporary healthcare. That will be vision in future, which will become probably a personalized medicine. PET CT, it is a tomographic imaging technique which allows non-invasive quantitative assessment of biochemical and functional processes. And it is a range of positron emitters are available for use. The commonest is FDG. PET CT has a particular value in cancer diagnosis and management, but is evolving in many other applications also. And CT is a technique which uses X-ray beam to generate images. Very good resolution to demonstrate the anatomy. And the integrated PET and CT in a single unit, imaging modality in clinical outcome. And integrated PET CT has been shown to be more accurate for lesion localization and characterization than either PET or CT, which are being done alone. So PET CT is an example of hybrid imaging. Image fusion, it involves the bringing together of two image data sets with the intention of registering them as closely as possible. Generally, the two image data sets would have been produced on different types of medical imaging devices. So various using two remote imaging devices into one physical unit, that is a concept of hybrid imaging, fusion imaging or fused imaging. The use of one imaging unit to produce two different image data sets has become a known hybrid imaging. And the examples of hybrid imaging devices include SPECT-CT, PET-CT, and now PET-MR. So what is the basis of this? Radio tracers. How radio tracers are being formed? So the area, the place where the radio tracers are formed is a cyclotron. A cyclotron is required to generate the positron emitting radionuclides that are used in PET imaging. And ideally, cyclotrons are located as close as possible to the PET scanner because the PET emitting radionuclides have very short half-lives. So ultimately, it depends on what is the half-life of a particular radio tracer and what is the application to be used. This is an image of a cyclotron, which is an automated self-shielded compact negative ion accelerator, which uses 11 MeV 60 microamps and 18 fluorine and 13 nitrogen chemical synthesis unit of FDG. So 18F and FDG have good characteristics, that is high spatial resolution, a relatively long half-life that permits longer synthetic procedures to be engaged with labeling and sufficient activity in a sample for the distance between the cyclotron and the PET scanner to be quite large. So FDG is a modified glucose molecule that is taken up into the cells by the same pathway as glucose. So the metabolic pathway is GLUT3 transporter, but it cannot be metabolized beyond initial phosphorylation to FDG6-phosphate. And that's why FDG uptake therefore depicts normal and abnormal metabolic activity. So normal biodistribution is very important to know in the cases where we have to differentiate between physiological and pathological uptakes. So normal metabolic activity is minimized in clinical imaging by asking patients to fast for a period of hours prior to the injection with the intention of achieving a hypoglycemic state, that is low blood sugar. There is normally a high uptake within the brain secondary to more increased glucose metabolism. And there is also a high activity in the urinary system as FDG is not trapped by the renal tubular cells, unlike normal glucose. So it will be excreted and landed up in the urinary system. There is also low FDG, low grade FDG activity in the liver due to glycolysis, and there can be a variable uptake in the myocardial cells. And muscle that has recently been exercised will also show FDG uptake, and for this reason, patients are encouraged to limit physiological activity prior to injection and scanning. Thus, intense uptake in the gray matter and the basal ganglia of the brain, moderately intense myocardial uptake, and intense activity in excreted urine in the renal collecting system and the bladder. So low-grade activity due to glycolysis is shown in liver and bone marrow. The lungs, although have low-level metabolic activity, are apparently total free of activity due to overcorrection from the very low CT values of air-containing lung in the attenuation correction system. The Juliet Curie's first artificially produced radionuclide, which was nitrogen-30, and promising PET isotope for the myocardial studies. So medical imaging with the PET primarily encompasses short-lived radioisotopes such as cyclotron producing 11 carbon, 13 nitrogen, 15 oxygen, and 18 fluoride as well. So generator produced gallium-68 and rubidium-82. The isotopes are usually produced by proton irradiation of natural or enriched targets. The physical properties of 18 positrons are emitted from a proton-rich nucleus undergoing beta decay. A positron travels a few millimeters, losing kinetic energy through collision with matter before it combines with a free electron. And the mass of the electron and is converted into two annihilation photons of 511 keV emitted in opposite directions, that is 180 degrees apart. So the radioactive atom of the radio tracer, they emit positrons. And the emitted positron combines with an electron after traveling a distance up to several millimeters in tissue. The positron and electron are then converted into two photons, each having an energy of 511 kV kilovolts, which are emitted in nearly opposite direction. This is based on the Einstein's principle. So PET image acquisition is based on the simultaneous coincidence detection of these two photons. A PET scanner consists of many photon detectors surrounding the patient. During a PET scan, millions of coincidence detections are collected, providing information about the distribution of the radio tracers in the tissue. There are various energy levels, like you have gamma rays, you have beta rays, and you have electrons. So the amount of KV, EV, that is energy, is percentage wise in different things. If you see, it is gamma rays, it is 511 KeV, betas it is 634, and electron it is 1. So positron emission, also known as beta plus decay, isobaric decay process, and proton inside a radionuclide nucleus is converted into a neutron while releasing a positron and a neutrino. So the decay process is characteristic of proton-rich radionuclides. Positron decay results in an element with an atomic number that is less than 1 unit. So while traveling, electron clouds of the surrounding materials, they retards until at last it completely loses its energy and combines with an electron to form an unstable system known as positronium, consisting of electron plus positron. Annihilate each other in a fraction of a second to produce two gamma rays photons. That is, process is known as annihilation process, and they have annihilation photons, each of 511 keV, and energy equivalent to the combined rest mass of an electron and a positron. So this, they emit energy in opposite directions at approximately 180 degrees to each other. So this is how the positron range beta plus and beta minus, and the residual energy leading to non-collinearity. So there is a coincidence circuit, and this is how the basis of positron emission happens. Now, PET scanners are built from many detectors. They are placed in different rings around the patient port. What are these detectors? They detect the amount of radionuclide activity, or they act as a precursor to collect the signals emitted from the radio tracers. And a clinical state-of-art PET system typically has a ring detector of 60 to 90 centimeters and an axial extent of 10 to 12, 25 centimeters. So the single PET detector is a high-density scintillating crystals which consist of BGO, lutetium, yttrium, ortho silicate, that is LSO, or lutetium, yttrium, ortho silicate, LYSO. So these, they convert the energy of photon striking the detector into the light. These are the different PET crystals: sodium iodide, BGO, LSO, and GSO. The commonly used till date was LSO. If you see the characteristic features, the density is 7.4, then the decay time is 35 to 45, and the photons energy is 28,000. So LSO is lutetium, orthi, oxy, ortho, silicate. So random coincidence arises from the simultaneous detection of two uncorrelated photons, that is photons coming from two different positron emissions. As these randoms are uncorrelated, their mutual directions are also uncorrelated, and an almost uniform background is added to measure 3D activity distribution. So PET CT systems, they use sophisticated random correction methods based on using either singles or a delayed coincidence time window method. So attenuation of photons in the patient causes loss of consciousness. So the number of measured coincidences depend on patient's radiological thickness, and the defects of attenuation can be easily compensated for by acquiring transmissions or CT scan. So thus, the coefficients are not directly applicable for 511 kV, and CT image needs to be converted into 511 kV attenuation coefficient image. So here, more than 99% of all 511 kV photons interactions in PET are by quantum scattering. This is a process where inelastic scattering of photons on the effectively free electrons. So this process results in the production of new photons with lower energy than the original beam that is emitted at an oblique angle relative to the direction of the unscattered photons. So modern PET systems are usually equipped with TOF capabilities. The big advantage of TOF PET is image contrast is improved and a noise reduction by the better localization of the annihilation process. So better the TOF resolution is, the higher the gain is on the SNR ratio. New detector designs are expected to improve the TOF resolution further in the future. So improvements on signal to noise ratios may be used to reduce the patient dose by administering less activity or by reducing the scan time in each patient. So thus, new technologies will continue to improve image quality process, providing the physician with an opportunity to reduce scan time per bed position or to lower the radioisotope injected dose. So TOF imaging seems to be particularly promising in terms of achieving a lower level of noise and better resolution compared with non-TOF imaging. So this benefit has already been shown in large patients, with the TOF gain being more sufficient when limited acquisition time and high attenuation reduces the total count in the images. In the same way, dynamic studies with the low statistics should also benefit from the enhanced image quality achieved with the TOF imaging. Coming to tumors, tumors consume more glucose than most of other tissues because of increased glycolysis, known as Warburg's effect, and this feature is exploited in the PET using FDG as a tracer. An FDG is a radio-labeled glucose analog whereby the 20-hydroxyl group has been substituted with 18-fluorine. Final steps in FDG synthesis. So this is a step where there are different acylated mannose, then acylated FDG, and then FDG. So different types of reactions and happening where the radioisotope FDG is being prepared. So that is how this is a cell, this is the blood from where it enters the cell. So there metabolism happens, and the concept of FDG and metabolic trapping is based on phosphorylation process. So what is it? Hyperglycemia and insulinemia impairs FDG uptake in tumors because of competitive uptake of FDG and glucose. So patients are asked to fast for at least 4 to 6 hours before FDG injection to reduce the insulin levels and facilitate the highest possible target to background ratio. So blood glucose levels should be within normal range, preferably less than 150 to 200 milligram per deciliter. With a higher level, scan should be rescheduled rather than being performed. So insulin-induced hypoglycemia reduces tumor uptake and facilitates physiologic uptake in the muscles and fat, thereby overall decreasing the tumor to background ratio. Here, different radio tracers are being used. Most common is the FDG, fluorine 18 FDG, but there are others based on the metabolic activities, like you have DNA synthesis, you have amino acids, you have muscle protein and membrane synthesis, you have overexpression of receptors, then you have blood flow vascularization, then hypoxic agents. Commonest positron emitters are radioisotope. Half-life 18 fluorine is commonly used because its half-life is average 110 minutes, 11 carbon 20 minutes, nitrogen 10 minutes, oxygen 2 minutes. So this is one of the reasons why we discuss that cyclotron, where the radioisotope is being prepared, should be as close to the PET as possible. And the most commonly tagged molecule is a glucose, with other things are also there, but commonly is glucose. What exactly is FDG? It is a metabolic contrast agent. It has a half-life of 110 minutes. It's very safe, no side effects. It's just a sugar. FDG uptake in tumor cells is marker of tumor glycolysis. So malignant cells have increased glucose. So this is the basis here. Patient injected, scan being done. These are LSO crystals where the detectors will detect the amount of energy, and it is being released on the basis of Einstein's principle at 180 degrees, 511 kV photons. And this is an uncorrected image. Again, uncorrected images has to be overlapped with the CT images to form a corrected image. So there are different applications where FDG is not successful. That is prostatic cancer, hepatoma, renal cell, bronchoalveolar carcinoma, and mucinous adenocarcinoma. CT parameters, most of us, we know everything technically about the number of slices, rotation, tube, heat, FOV, time, slice, width, and patient. So there is a quantification of the PET image now by standardized uptake value. It is SUV. So there are a lot of factors which affect the biological processes. There is uptake period, patient motion, and breathing and blood glucose levels. So technical factors again are depending on dose calibrator, activity in the syringe, incorrect synchronization, injection versus calibration time, and quality of administration. So these are different technical things which are not much mandatory, but remember about this. FDG uptake varies over time. So time interval between the injected applied FDG administration and the start of PET study must be matched as closely as possible between the scans. So generally, an ideal interval of 60 minutes with a tolerance of plus or 5 minutes is considered acceptable when PET studies are performed for response monitoring purposes. An appropriate time interval between the end of therapy cycle and the PET study needs to be considered, as FDG uptake may vary strongly after chemotherapy. This applies again for the post-surgical. Usually, we are not supposed to do any PET scan till the 6 weeks, because any sort of post-operative changes versus the uptake due to tumor and any post-treatment changes, very difficult to differentiate. So that is one of the places where we can get the false results. So as they both glucose and FDG are actively transported into cells, glucose levels affect the amount of FDG uptake and thereby CV. So that is one of the reasons you should be fasting. And high blood glucose levels will result in lower uptake of FDG and thereby lower CV values. So when not properly taken into account, a high blood glucose level may give wrong results in the form of SCVP, which is therefore important that blood glucose are within a normal range before FDG administration. And usually the normal blood glucose, the PET CT should be preferably be rescheduled if it is more than the normal. So the difference between injection time and a start of PET CT acquisition, it provides the uptake period, which should be as close as possible to 60.